Now that we have explored some important properties of metals and semiconductors, we can finally understand what happens when we bring a metal and semiconductor together. In this video, we will look into deep detail at the metal-semiconductor junction. In the previous video, we already discussed the need for metals to collect the photo-generated current in the solar cell, and I introduced the work function defined as the energy difference between the vacuum level and the Fermi level of a given material. This work function expresses the work required to release an electron from that material. I also introduced the electron affinity of a semiconductor, which is defined as the energy difference between the vacuum level and the bottom of the conduction band. In this video, we will join the metal and semiconductor to form a metal-semiconductor junction. We will do that using an n-type semiconductor, but the physics is the same when a p-type semiconductor is used. In this video, we will see two types of metal-semiconductor junctions, a so-called Schottky barrier junction and an ohmic junction. We will not deal yet with the current flow, but focus only on the band diagrams that will illustrate this junction. So be prepared to see many band diagrams today. Let's start with the band diagrams of the metal and semiconductor that we have seen earlier. In this case, the band diagrams of the two materials have been lined up along the vacuum level. If we take a look at the Fermi levels, then we see a difference between the metal and the semiconductor. We define this difference as phi ms and is called the metal semiconductor work function difference. This is what the two materials look like when they are apart. However, when we want to bring the two materials together, the band diagrams should not line up along the vacuum level, but along the Fermi level, as we can see here. This is because in thermal equilibrium, the electrochemical potential in the system should be the same anywhere. We then see the metal semiconductor work function difference in the vacuum level. This difference represents a potential barrier that needs to be accommodated in the system. We now bring the two materials towards each other. In order to connect the semiconductor band diagram to the metal band diagram, we need to realize that at the junction, the vacuum level must be continuous. When we know where the semiconductor band diagram joins that of the metal, we can draw the region in between the metal and the quasi-neutral region. This region varies parabolically with position, as we will see in a moment. In the quasi-neutral region of the bands of the semiconductor are horizontal, reflecting the fact that there is no voltage drop across this region. The energy difference between where the conduction band meets the metal and the Fermi level is called the Schottky barrier, phi bn. This barrier represents the energy required for electron injection from the metal to the semiconductor, and is a characteristic for this junction. When we now define phi n as the energy difference between the bottom of the conduction band and the Fermi level in the semiconductor, we can see easily that the metal semiconductor work function difference is equal to the difference between the Schottky barrier and phi n. This difference will form a barrier for electrons to travel from the n-type semiconductor to the metal, and is the built-in potential barrier VBI, similar to the built-in potential for a PN junction, and obstructs straightforward collection of electrons in the semiconductor by the metal. The region in between the metal and the quasi-neutral region is the depletion region, and this region has a width XD. Now let's have a more detailed look at this depletion region. For this, we first look at the charge density in this region. As the word depletion implies, this region is depleted of free charge carriers, free electron in the case of n-type semiconductor. As a result, the charge density in this region is formed by positively charged donor ions that are fixed in the semiconductor lattice. In the depletion region, this charge density is constant as a function of position. Evidently, charge neutrality imposes that an equal amount of negative charge is present in the metal near the interface. In this slide, I have drawn this as a rectangle, but in reality, this should be surface charge right at the interface with the semiconductor. We now can work out the electric field distribution F using the Poisson equation. From this equation, we can see easily that if the charge density does not vary with position, the electric field will vary linearly with position. Subsequently, we can infer from Gauss's law that at the edge of the depletion region in the semiconductor, the electric field strength is zero, and we find the electric field distribution. Applying the Poisson equation, again, we find the electrostatic potential phi, and we see that this will vary parabolically with x. Note that this is the electrostatic potential for positive charge. In the band diagram, we draw the energy levels for negative charge, and therefore the bands in the depletion region will vary in the opposite direction, as I have illustrated in this slide. When we know the built-in voltage of this junction and the charge density in the depletion region, we can work out the depletion region width. And we see that this width depends on the square root of the built-in voltage and dopant concentration, similar to a PN junction of which the p-type region is very highly doped. So far, we constructed the band diagram of this junction in thermal equilibrium. Now let's apply a bias voltage to the system. We will first consider the case in which we apply a forward bias voltage, which means a negative voltage on the n-type semiconductor with respect to the metal. As a result, the quasi-neutral part of the n-type semiconductor will be at a higher potential energy, and the barrier for electrons to travel from the semiconductor to the metal is reduced from VBI to VBI minus VA, where VA is the applied voltage. As remarked earlier, the Schottky barrier at the junction is determined by the metal work function and semiconductor electron affinity only, and does not change. We then can draw again the depletion region in between the quasi-neutral region and the metal. Looking more closely at this depletion region, we see that the width of this region has reduced, similar to what we have seen for a PN junction under forward bias. Also now, we can draw the charge density in the depletion region, but need to take into account that the width has reduced. Applying the Poisson equation, we then can work out the electric field and potential distribution. Note that the slope of the electric field distribution has not changed, as this slope is determined by the charge density in the depletion region, which is in turn to be equal to the dopant concentration. And this dopant concentration has not changed. Now we have seen the junction for forward bias, we can repeat the story for reverse bias voltage. In that case, the Fermi level of the semiconductor is below that of the metal, and the barrier for electrons to travel from the semiconductor to the metal has increased from VBI to VBI plus VR, where VR is the applied voltage. In a similar fashion as before, we can draw the Schottky barrier and the depletion region. We can see here that applying a reverse bias increases the depletion region width. Please work out the width of this depletion region yourself. So far, we looked at a metal semiconductor junction of which the work function of the semiconductor was smaller than that of the metal. We now look at the case in which the work function of the n-type semiconductor is larger than that of the metal. Like we have seen before, for the Schottky barrier junction, the Fermi level and thermal equilibrium should line up. Again, we find where the conduction band of the semiconductor joins the metal and subsequently form the junction. Comparing this junction to the Schottky barrier junction we saw earlier, we see some striking differences. First of all, there is no barrier for electrons in the conduction band of the semiconductor to travel to the metal. As we will see in the following video, this absence will ease the current flow, and therefore such a junction is often called an ohmic junction. Secondly, we see that the bands in the semiconductor bend downwards. This is not a depletion region, but due to the bending resulting from the differences in work function, this will increase the electron density near the junction. We now can summarize this video as follows. We have discussed how to form a metal semiconductor junction and seen that if the work function of the n-type semiconductor is smaller than the metal work function, we obtain a Schottky barrier junction. Vice versa, if the n-type semiconductor work function is larger, an ohmic junction is obtained. Note that I have stressed this summary that the semiconductor is n-type. Also, when using a p-type semiconductor, similar properties can be found, though the work functions of the two materials compare in a different way. Please try to find out if the metal work function should be larger or smaller than of the p-type semiconductor in order to have a Schottky barrier.